It really does take a village, and I know I'll forget someone if I try to thank everyone, but I want to say that behind the curtains, behind the cameras, my wonderful colleagues from our media team and our events team, Molly, Kayla, Ben, Emily, I could go on, and the folks who make everything look so beautiful, we appreciate all of you and all of the staff people who helped get us here today. There is one person who I need to give some special recognition to, and that is Dr. Vinnie Pompei. I wanted to, yes, give it up for Vinnie. Friday night, Mary Beth Maxwell referred to Vinnie as the backbone of this conference, and I want to say that that was only a partial anatomy lesson. He is the heart and soul of Time to Thrive. If you love the themes and the stories and the workshops and the overall feel and tone of Time to Thrive, that is because Vinnie Pompei has a magic touch. He is so incredibly passionate about and committed to our LGBTQ youth, and every day just comes to work and does his absolute best, and you've seen it come to full fruition here. So thank you so much, Vinnie. I love working with you. I respect the hell out. Before we bring out our next speaker, our last speaker, I want to share some exciting news. All of you were among the first to know. We've talked a lot about research over the last couple of days and how important it is to shed light on the vital needs facing LGBTQ youth. And we've also addressed that there's a knowledge gap, and those are sadly growing in this administration. And that's why in the coming weeks, HRC and researchers at the University of Connecticut are launching a major survey of LGBTQ teens across the United States. In 2012, HRC surveyed more than 10,000 LGBTQ teens about their experiences in schools and at home and in their communities. The results were astounding and have helped us better understand and advocate for LGBTQ youth. In fact, those findings several years ago led to us to launch this conference and bring Vinnie on board and expand our programs to support LGBTQ youth. The next survey, which will launch in the next week or two, will paint a much more detailed picture of LGBTQ teens in today's US. A lot has changed since our 2012 survey. We're a country with far more identities, and our youth are facing a terrible backlash right now, particularly if they are LGBTQ youth of color, transgender, immigrants, or living with a disability, on and on. Through the survey, we'll use tested, validated questions to understand much more about their health, including experiences with substance abuse, disordered eating, and mental health, as well as what's happening in their families, in their schools, and in their broader communities. We will need your help. We'd like to make sure we get a large and diverse cross-section of youth across the country. So keep an eye out for an email after the conference with more information about how you can help to spread the word. Now it is my great honor and pleasure to bring back to the stage Sarah McBride, HRC's National Press Secretary, and our HRC Youth Ambassadors. Come on up!
Are you fired up? Are you ready to go? All right. I would just want to start by saying it's an honor to stand on stage with HRC's youth ambassadors. The truth is that every time a young leader speaks, they speak from a place of history. Not the history of the past, but the history that remains to be written. Young people will be the ones that write the history books of tomorrow. We will get to decide who was right and who was wrong in this moment. And elected officials, they know that. And so it's an honor to stand on stage with you. Every time you speak, every word you say from a place of authenticity, of power, of urgency, and of history. So let's give them another round of applause. Five years ago today, I came out as transgender while serving as student body president at American University just up the street. And that's right. And I have to admit that at the time, I was scared. I worried about rejection in every sense of the word, and I wondered whether the heart of this country was big enough to love someone like me. But because of my luck, because of my privilege, because of family, friends, and educators who stood by my side, I've been fortunate enough to see that my dreams and my identity do not have to be mutually exclusive. Unfortunately, today in America and around the world, that experience is far from the reality for everyone. But it shouldn't, and it doesn't have to be that way. It shouldn't have to be a privilege to keep your family. It shouldn't have to be a privilege to keep your home. It shouldn't have to be a privilege to be safe from violence. As a 26-year-old transgender woman, I can now reflect on many of the central elements of a safe, supportive, and healthy journey. Supportive parents, friends, counselors, teachers, people who listened, who affirmed, who learned along with me. All of you in this room are part of that prescription for LGBTQ youth everywhere. What you say, what you do, how you show up and step up all pave the path for young people, creating ripples of hope that empower others, save lives, and improve our world. We need you. We need you now perhaps more than we have in a very long time. We find ourselves and our country at a moment of choosing. This is no ordinary time, and we must decide whether we will be a nation that says there's only one way to love, only one way to look, and only one way to live, or whether together we will build a world where everyone has the freedom to live openly and equally. LGBTQ people, and particularly LGBTQ youth, have significant challenges ahead of us. But even with those obstacles, even with all of the hate, even with Donald Trump in the White House, we continue to defy the odds, bring change, and make history. It's the change that's allowed more families and friends, coworkers and classmates to welcome an LGBTQ loved one with broad smiles and with open hearts. It's the change that allows all of us to stand on this stage in our power and in our authenticity. It's the change that's taken a movement from Stonewall to the steps of the Supreme Court and bent the arc of the moral universe just a little bit more towards justice. It's the change that allows a young trans girl of color to grow up and see Laverne Cox on television, and a young gay boy in Kansas to go to sleep on a Friday night in June of 2015, having just seen the White House, the symbol of our country lit up like a rainbow. But all of us know that we are far from finished. After all, the fundamental truth remains that no one in the LGBTQ community is totally equal until everyone, from the gay Muslim refugee to the queer undocumented youth to the transgender woman of color living right here in Washington, D.C., until every single one of us is treated with dignity and fairness. But with all of you by our side, speaking out, acting up, and standing in solidarity, that day will come. And when it does, when our understanding of we the people finally includes all of us, a young queer student or a young trans student will grow up and learn about this struggle for justice and equality in their textbooks, and never have to know what this progress felt like to all of us, because they will never know anything different. And that will be because of advocates and activists who dreamed of a different world. It'll be because of educators who fostered knowledge and provided hope. It'll be because of these youth ambassadors who led this movement from a place of urgency and history. and it will be because of you. As you head back to your communities, the youth ambassadors and I just have one thing we wanted to say. Thank you. Thank you all very much.